Good afternoon. I'd like to call our meeting to order for the Pensacola City Council for September 16th, 2011. This is a special meeting of City Council. We may only discuss the agenda item. And this meeting was called by the mayor. Will the mayor be coming today? So I'll need a member of the mayor's staff.
Madam President. Madam President, thank you. The mayor called the special call to consider the rate ordinance pertaining to ESP.
Council, would you like to hear from members of the audience before we begin any deliberation? I know that we need to have a motion and a second at this point. Are there any changes to this from the original proposed ordinance from committee?
Madam President, I believe that there were some ministerial corrections on some typos, obviously, that were submitted to council as part of the backup agenda.
Madam Clerk, with the adjustments, is it still required that we have a vote to bring it from being tabled in committee?
That is my understanding from council's rules and procedures, but I defer to the attorney.
You're correct, Madam President.
So we will not need a vote?
No, we will need a vote.
We will need a vote since
yes,
it was
ma'am.
Tabled.
We need to make sure everybody understands the playing field. We'll need a motion with, of course, a second to bring the tabled proposal off the table and back in front of the council. And that will take six votes to pass.
And Councilman Spencer was the maker of the motion. Does the second need to be the second in committee, or can it be anyone? Just anyone?
Just anyone.
Thank you, ma'am. Okay, I'll accept a motion if there is one.
All right. I make a motion that City Council take the ordinance amendment entitled Schedule of Gas Rates and Charges, dated September 6, 2011, from the table committee.
From the committee. Motion?
Second.
Motion and a second. Your light is on, Mr. Spencer. Did you have comments? You're the maker of the motion. You can begin or
no,
can clear your light.
It's apparently stuck.
Okay. Councilwoman yeah. Myers.
Yes.
Is it stuck? There. Well, okay, now it's clear. No touchy. Unless you want to. We got it clear, though. Thank you. Okay, Ms. Myers.
Well, one thing that concerns me is that
Council President, I apologize for interrupting. Councilwoman Myers, I apologize for interrupting. Are we now talking about discussing whether to remove the motion from the table or discussing the motion?
Discussing bringing it back to.
Okay, now my understanding, subject to, my understanding is that motion is not debatable.
Okay.
In other words, we vote on the motion
to bring it back,
and then we
need a motion.
Then the council, I take a leadership role in these things. Then the council can debate the motion.
Okay.
So, and I apologize for cutting you off, Councilwoman
okay.
Myers.
Certainly.
Well,
so
let me be
debate.
Clear what you're saying. You're saying that under Robert's Rules of Order, is that what we're going by?
Yes, ma'am.
That a motion to untable something is not debatable.
That's what I'm saying, yes, ma'am.
So what we would be debating is the motion that's taken off the table.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Madam Clerk, are we clear on this? Is it debatable or not?
Motion to remove from to bring back from the table is non-debatable.
But the motion, once it's made, will
then.
Okay, so we will have no debate on this. I have a motion and a second.
So we've got two parliamentarians here. That's good.
Three, maybe. Let's go ahead and vote, Council. Passes 7-1, and Dr. Pratt is not present for the meeting. Okay, so we have the item that has been brought back from the committee, and this is a recommendation from the mayor, so the mayor's office has the floor for the recommendation. The subject is ordinance, schedule of gas rates and charges. You have the floor.
Madam President, I defer to the council's prerogative.
Well, the recommendation needs to be read into the record by the mayor's staff.
Madam Clerk.
Proposed ordinance number 28-11, an ordinance to be entitled, an ordinance amending section 10-4-19 of the Code of the City of Pensacola entitled Schedule of Rates and Charges, providing for severability, repealing clause, providing an effective date.
Council, what's your pleasure? Is there a motion?
Well, we brought it back from the table. I don't know that we need to move it a second time, do we? Yeah. I mean, we already brought it. The motion was made in a previous meeting. We voted to bring it back for consideration.
But that was to table it, sir. It wasn't actually to consider it.
But we brought
it. It was tabled.
It was tabled, but we brought it back from that. And the recommendation had been made before.
Okay. So we're discussing the recommendation at this time,
so
not
now
the
we're
actual
discussing
ordinance.
You don't need a motion and a second on that.
Thank you. Okay. Any discussion from council? Ms. Myers.
Yes, I just want to state why I will not be voting for this. I sat through some of the meeting yesterday on the Gulf Power proposed rate increases, and that facility was packed out, standing like sardines. I heard numerous people state over and over again what a hard time people are having today in this economy. Senator Doug Broxson was there, and he made a statement that really hit home. He said, "We've reached the breaking point." He said, "We've cut out all the fat, and now we're cutting into the bone." And I not only heard testimony from a state senator, ordinary citizens, but also some businesses about how increases in utilities are going to be hurting them. I cannot in good conscience vote for this. I picked up the newspaper this morning and read a very good viewpoint by John Peacock. And he said two things I think we need to keep in mind. Of course, he was talking about nonprofits and the fact that they're not doing as well in these hard economic times as they've done in the past. But he says the needs of our local communities, however, have not declined and will likely increase. We have to do more with less. And he goes on to say, but local governments are also dealing with significantly less revenue. The only choices are to increase revenue at the local level, taxes and fees, or be more efficient with the resources we currently have. And that's actually what I have had proposed when I offered my suggestion that we might want to look at reducing the budget, at least back to where it was, or close to where it was in 2011, is to be more efficient with the resources we currently have, as opposed to raising taxes and fees. Of course, we already have voted to raise every fee we can possibly raise, I guess, on anything. And I have supported those increases. But this one, I can't in good conscience, and I will not support it. I think there's an alternative. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilwoman. Councilman Gerald.
Thank you, Madam President. Excuse me. As you all can probably recall, on the other day, I was one of those who voted to not table the motion or the action. And there was quite a bit of support to table it and come back at a later time, which means today. But the argument then was the fact that we did not have the budget in hand, and it would have implied that to move forward, we would have been moving about blindfolded in the dark. What I need to know today is what's different and why are we back today? What's different about it? That's one thing I need to know. And the second thing I'd like to know is whether or not, you know, the 10% has been tossed around, but had we looked at any other percentages that we could consider before taking this action, and hopefully I'll hear something coming from someone up here letting us know that if it's 5%, half of what had been asked for, and as Ms. Myers mentioned a second ago, reducing the overall budget to be more in line with our shrinking population in the city of Pensacola. So I just need some answers, because it appears to me that if we're looking at the same plan, the same procedure that we're going to follow, that we could have very well followed on Monday, because if nothing has changed, it's the same thing. So I need to know where we are and what's going on here. What's the question? Has anything changed that would make us feel more comfortable moving forward?
Thank you, Councilman. And I know this was tabled for an opportunity to compromise. Is there someone on the mayor's staff that could address the changes that were made and how they will affect the rates?
Madam President, Councilman Geralds, the recommendation that was brought forth by the mayor's office in committee was to improve an increase in the rates, and also the rate study that accompanied based on the consultant's recommendation. Other than minor corrections in the ordinance, nothing has changed from that date to this date. Mr. Swore is here to go into details as to why the mayor believes that the rate increase is justified.
Mr. Suarez, that was part one. And part two of my question, so nothing has actually changed. It's the same thing that we could have very well done, either voted up or voted down a couple of days ago. So.
Do you need further explanation from Mr. Barker?
Madam Chair, what about the second part of the question? Was 10% the only number that was looked at, or could we consider a motion to consider 5%, 6%, or something that would perhaps be more palatable to the public? But has 10% that number edged in stone, and you know we have no wiggle room, no negotiating opportunity here?
Mr. Asmar?
Madam President, Councilman, the mayor, based on the recommendations by the consultant, the city's consultant, and based on the recommendations by Mr. Suarez, he believes that what's on the table is justified and supported. Obviously, the council has discretion whether to approve, amend, or not to approve.
Is there a member of staff that can explain the options that Mr. Geralds has asked about, please?
Madam President, Mr. Suarez.
Thank you, Madam President, Councilman Geralds. The rate study is based on the financial position that ESP is in and the needs of ESP financially to support the ongoing operations of the system. It also includes a clause that will take place in 2013 that will allow us to recover the cost of infrastructure improvements that are required by a regulatory agency such as the Public Service Commission and the Federal Pipeline Hazardous Materials Safety Administration. These improvements are required because the system is old and we have outdated and obsolete infrastructure in place that needs replacing, and we've got to deal with it. I would like to be able to tell you that there's some sort of negotiable room with the rate, but there just isn't. The fact is the study is based on our financial needs to operate the system safely and effectively and to serve our customers in the manner in which they are expected to be served. There's no enhanced service in here. There's no enhancements whatsoever which would allow some margin there that could go away and just not do the enhancements. It's all simply for ongoing operations for the 6.9% plus the adder that comes in 2013 that will allow us to make the improvements that are required by regulatory agencies.
Thank you.
Councilman, does that take care of your questions?
Yes, it does.
Thank you. Councilman Hall.
Well, Mr. Gerald, thank you for your inquiry, and I do just want to respond to one thing. It's not a 10% increase, it's a 6.9%. And I know that Gulf Power is looking at 10 plus, and that's what was reported in the paper, but for us it's 6.9. And even that's divided into a couple of different things. That's the aggregate of the increase, what we need for the infrastructure and what we need for the operating costs. Madam Chair, if you would allow, I've got some questions for the mayor's staff, if I could, please.
Certainly.
Mr. Asmar, I think it would probably be Mr. Suarez best able to answer this stuff. The 6.9% increase, where will that put ESP as a break-even in a normal winter?
Mr. Suarez.
We'll be able to make the transfer, and it will be essentially a balanced budget.
Balanced budget. So if we don't do the 6.9%, then either you're going to be operating at a deficit or we'll have to reduce the transfer to the city in the budget that we've already approved.
That's accurate, yes, sir.
Okay. And last year was a normal winter, and we lost $3 million.
That's correct.
And this year, what is it predicted to be? Normal winter, colder, warmer?
I don't know. I'm not sure what the National Weather Service is predicting for this coming year. I do know that we always budget for a normal winter.
For a normal winter, okay.
Yes,
okay. And that 6.9% increase provides no new revenue to you?
That's correct. It's based on a normal winter and based on balancing our budget.
And that is because we need the 6.9% increase. One, I understand part of it's for infrastructure and the other part for operating costs. But if we had followed procedure that City Council had adopted for itself in previous years, we'd only need, let me see here, I'm looking around, about 1.9% increase this year, which would be very palatable, I think, even in rough economic times for this council to do. But because we rejected our own policy in previous years, the reason we're having to go up to this.
I believe you're referring to the CPI increase
that
is built into, that was approved by council in 2007. And yes, sir, that's correct. If the CPI increases had been allowed to take place, then we would only need 1.9%.
Okay, now back to the infrastructure part of it. Now, I take it that the data I have before me is in regard to that alone, is that agreement you reached with the Public Service Commission that took over 2 years. Mm-hmm. If it's not funded, the city will be in violation of that agreement. Is that right?
Yes, sir. If I may elaborate a little bit, the authority comes from the federal government. The State Public Service Commission actually does the investigation and verification that we're following the procedures and the regulations established by PHMSA, which is an acronym for the Pipeline and Hazardous Safety's Materials Administration. And a couple of years ago, they passed a new regulation. To throw another acronym at you, it's called DIMP. It's the Distribution Integrity Management Plan. And all gas systems throughout the country are required to have a DIMP plan. What basically this is it identifies the hazards in your system, the weak areas that need attention, and it mandates that you pursue replacement or repair of those weak areas of your system in order to be in compliance. And the Public Service Commission in Florida regulates that plan, and this is part of that plan, this infrastructure replacement program. So we would be out of compliance and at risk of some sort of reparations from, not reparations,
fine.
Repercussions is what we're looking at.
Well, the data I have in front of me, and just tell me if this is accurate or not, to the best of your knowledge, is that if we're found in non-compliance with that agreement, ESP could be fined up to $250,000 a day.
That's correct.
And that's for a $2.5 million cap.
Yes, sir.
Which is, where would you get that money? Since we're already, if we don't approve this increase, you're already going to be expend your reserves. And if we were fined up to that $2.5 million, where would you have to go to find that money? Could you issue a bond for that, or would you have to come to the city for that?
Mr. Barker would have to answer whether or not that's bondable. I wouldn't think fines are bondable, but I could be wrong about that.
I wouldn't think so either, but it was almost a rhetorical question. But my guess is you'd have to come to the city.
Yes, sir.
For that money, to pay up those fines. Okay. And this one, I'm not asking you to sit down. This may be more for Mr. Asmar here. But my understanding is that if the increase is not approved, then one of three things must happen. That we're going to have to reduce the transfer by $3 million or some portion of that, deplete the ESP reserves, or operate the system in an unsafe manner.
That's correct.
Okay. Now, unsafe manner. This is something, as I've been talking to staff, I was hesitant to bring up because I don't want to overly alarm the public. But downtown Pensacola, at what rate of pressure do you operate your system at?
A quarter pound on the downtown area.
In the downtown area. And
yes,
now, what do you do it up in my area that's up by Cordova Mall?
60 pounds.
60 pounds.
Correct.
So quarter pound down here, 60 pounds up there. Now, is the difference... Does it have to do with safety?
No, the difference actually has to do with the age of the pipe. The system in the downtown area is primarily cast iron main, and it began to be installed around 1890, and so you can imagine how old it is. And at that time, the pressure regulation wasn't as sophisticated, and so you ran house pressure in those cast iron mains, and we had much bigger pipes then. System is still active.
Okay, but if you were to run that at 60 pounds?
It would be Swiss cheese.
Okay, it'd be Swiss cheese. And so part of which this funding would be going to replace those oldest pipes.
Correct.
Okay. My understanding in talks with you earlier is that the ESP rates are actually lower right now than they were from 2005 to 2009.
That's correct. Even with the increase, they'll still be lower.
Even with the increase, they'll still be lower?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then my question then, I guess, for Mr. Asmar is, if council does not approve this increase, are we going to deplete the ESP reserves, or are we going to lay off firemen in District 3?
Madam President, Councilman, the reason why the mayor is supporting staff's recommendation and the consultant's recommendation is to thwart that potential. Obviously, a $3 million cut in the general fund would mean...
And that's a $3 million cut, or $3 million budget that the council has already approved.
Madam President, Mr. Hall, the second public hearing is May 28th, and I think at that point in time, the budget would be approved.
September 28th.
I'm sorry, September 28th. So, technically, you haven't approved that budget, and the mayor concurs with your delay until this matter can be discussed, so that if this council chooses not to support the recommendation before you, then this council he would urge this council to amend the budget to reflect the overall net decrease.
So you're saying then that you would be looking to council to recommend where the cuts would come from. The mayor has given us a balanced budget, what he thinks that he needs to operate the city. So he's done his job. Now, if we want to come up with anything less than that, he would expect the council to give him very specific direction in where to make those cuts.
Madam President, council member, that is correct. Pursuant to the new form of government, the executive branch has presented a budget for consideration. And pursuant to the legislative branch authority, they have a right to consider an appropriate. So at this point in time, it is not proper for him to amend the budget once it's been presented to City Council. It's exclusively the authority of the council.
Thank you, Madam President.
Thank you, Councilman, for your commentary. Dr. Pratt, welcome.
Thank you, Madam President. I apologize. I had a commitment that I had made well before the two-day notice we had. So I just wanted to address Mr. Hall's comment, and it's a comment I've heard elsewhere, that the council needs to give a balance. If we don't accept these changes, we need to give a balanced budget. And I think that that's a valid wish. Unfortunately, I think that if we start coming up with numbers, we're not going to make very educated guesses. I could just say, okay, well, let's cut this charge and that charge, but I don't have any information unless I work with the mayor's staff to figure out the numbers. So I think it has to be a collaborative thing. If this rate increase is not passed, then we would need to work with the mayor's office, because there are a lot of assumptions. For instance, what if the rate increase doesn't pass? Maybe people will use more gas. We can't make those assumptions without advice from the mayor's administration. And so I think we could come up with numbers. We could present a balanced budget, but I don't know that it will be a workable budget if we don't work with the mayor to come up with valid numbers. And so I just wanted to address that. I've heard it in many forms, but in this short time frame and without access to those who have greater information than we collectively have as the 9-member body, then it won't be a very valid budget if we are called upon to balance it in if we don't support this rate increase. I think it would be incumbent upon the mayor and the mayor's staff to help us find numbers that will work. Thank you, Madam President.
Thank you, Dr. Pratt. Councilman Gerald.
Yes, I have another question, perhaps a diagnostic type. But having approved the other rate increases that were in the budget packet, and after listening to Mr. Suarez and Mr. Barker, would it be correct to assume that from what I'm hearing now and the juncture that we're at, that we have one foot in hell and the other one on a banana peel? Is that where we are?
Councilman, and I'll ask the attorney to chime in a moment. In my discussions with, I'm not sure if it's the banana peel or hell, let's see, but the discussions about the budget and how it is presented, and because we do have now an elect official presenting the budget to an elected body, but that the budget is a point-in-time snapshot and a plan for our city. You see that we do supplemental budget resolutions on a regular basis. Dollars are reappropriated for different uses. Revenues are reallocated because there are more or less, if there's less revenue than we expected. So it is a plan and a process to move forward with, but the ordinances that we approve for the rates are completely separate. And I did a little research after this, after it was tabled, and also after the budget was not voted on and we recessed that meeting. And I went back to 2007, and I've done a few things for council. You'll see in front of you a few documents here. The first one was the ESP rate adjustment history, for council to have a better understanding of the rate adjustments that have actually been done. It shows the year 2000 with an explanation, and then it shows in 2007 the rate increase that occurred then, and that was based on the Black and Veatch rate study at that time. And it's funny how much the study actually reads much the same as the one that we read just last week for the proposed increases this time. And it did pass. There was two no votes coming out of committee from Councilman Hall and Townsend, so maybe they feel our pain at this point. But it did get passed. I do want to point out, though, that part of this process, the date on this discussion in 2007 was May, and it was completely separate from the budget. And when it is a rate that is this much of an increase for the citizens and the users that are not city residents, it deserves that consideration. And obviously that was taken care of way in advance of budget discussions. So the rate vote is completely separate from the budget, and we are not required to bring the amendments forward with the changes, because we can approve the budget as a point in time, and then it's on to business the first day of the new fiscal year, and that is the way that I understand it. And I will ask Mr. Messer if he'd like to chime in with his thoughts, and also I discussed that issue with Mr. Barker, if he would like to have the floor after Mr. Messer.
Madam President, I know this is a very serious matter for the city and the council and the mayor, but I would just point out I would not like to chime in, but I will,
you certainly
since
aren't required.
You've asked me. I will chime in to this extent that what you have just stated is feasible, although clearly we're in a situation where we're almost analogous to the issues that we face with the president and the Congress over our national budget. I was going to use the word brinksmanship, but I didn't. But the fact is, we have 10 working days left to perform our statutory and charter imposed duties to achieve a balanced budget. And hopefully that will answer the question.
Mr. Barker, did you have anything to add? Welcome.
Thank you, Madam President, and members of the City Council. That is correct. This is the first time we've come this close to a budget situation that we're in. But I would be remiss as the Chief Financial Officer for the City of Pensacola not to add some comments, if the Chair would allow me.
Certainly.
On this particular issue, I understand we're addressing the ESP rate increase. You have heard me through the years, the council members that have been on here, even as the cuts that we began, the reductions we began, and part of the 30-month budget, which ended up being a 42-month budget, and even going into this, that we're in good fiscal condition. We have not given employees raises since 2008, and we've reduced a number of positions over this time. Now, but I would come up and sit before you and say the city's in good fiscal condition. One of the main things that I would say is that's because we have not drawn down our fund balances as part of the budget. We're living within revenue and expenses. That's how this budget was designed, to stay within council's policies and that council has adopted and have been consistent in our revenue and expense. ESB is charged with giving, according to your policy, a transfer to the general fund. It is charged with operating the system safely. And that's so, you know, in all the rates and different things that have been mentioned. But we're bordering on, if you don't keep your revenue and expenses in line, you're bordering on that you will not hear me say that we are in good fiscal condition. In 1 year, we're going to draw $2.8 million down from ESP. I'd have to go back and look, but it has been many years, because I don't remember them, since that happened. We went through in 2000 and redesigned rates. We looked at it because what we had was not working, and a whole new rate structure was designed. It was designed in such a way that in 2007, that we said, okay, we're going to take care of this for the future for CPI, because we understand in order to protect the system, there's going to have to be growth to that system, and we need to at least adjust rates by CPI. We said in the ordinance that that would automatically happen in the budget, but that council would get to look at it, and if they chose not to do the rate increase, we would not do the rate increase. Now, there's all kind of reasons for not doing the rate increase, and I understand that at a particular time. But you're at the end of a 42-month period. You have a new government. And the fact of the matter is, this budget was presented by the mayor and with council's policies. It wasn't his policies. He's looked at the council policies and say, yeah, we need to get back. It's been 42 months. We need to get back and get the budget balanced. Now, my concern is the financial condition of the city. And so with that all said, and the number of days that the city attorney has mentioned and that type of thing and getting this budget passed, that it's concerning to me. I've worked here going on 31 years. It's concerning to me that as far as we have come, where we have our reserves built up, where you have an enterprise, which is a business, which has to be a department of the city because it's part of the city, but we've looked at it as a business. You're looking at, in my opinion, the smallest increase that we could have. We went through that rate study, looked at it, and just did the bare minimum. Nothing is being asked for with bells and whistles in this. ESP is your biggest contributing enterprise to the general fund. I would just say, be careful you don't kill it. And when I say that, the talk about rate increase, the issues that we're dealing with, the employees not being able to get compensation, and we understand it's also the worst economic times that I've seen since I've been with the city the 30 years, and I understand that, and we're going through that. But my concern is the fiscal condition of the city. I want to be able to come to you and say it's still good. Yeah, we had to reduce positions, not by layoffs, but we've had to reduce positions because we kept them unfilled in order to balance this thing for the last 42 months. We've been able to reduce this. We've reduced that. We haven't given pay raises. We've done all those things, and you've heard it from the employees. Now, with this budget, there is no pay raises included in this budget again for the employees. Mr. Suarez is run an efficient system, but there's not waste out there that is going to be made up. So in March of this year, I informed the mayor, put in my quarterly report, I believe it was around March, probably got to council in April, May time frame, but the written report was done in my monthly summary. I said ESP is going to have a problem. I said airport's going to have a problem. And, you know, maybe knowing that the $2.8 million was there, that we were going to be short, an immediate rate increase could have happened. You can adjust rates anytime. So maybe we should have had an immediate rate increase, but we wanted to see what was going to happen, what was going to happen in the 12 budget, and that type of thing. But the reserves at ESP was about 14%, should be 15% towards policy. If you do this, they're going to be drawn down another $2.8 million for sure. My concern, Mr. Suarez just said that you have he's budgeted a normal winter as we always have. If we don't get another normal winter, are we going to be another $2.8 million down? And then you're really going to be in a fix. And when I say you are, the city and the citizens are going to be in a fix. Maybe that's too much comment, but I enjoy being able to come to you and say the city's in good financial condition. I enjoy being able to look at our finances and our CAFR and saying that it is good shape and have people from the outside look at it and say this city's in a good shape when you look at other Florida cities that say they've had to do layoffs and all kind of other things. Now, you know, y'all are talking about a rate increase. I'm talking about the financial condition of the city. I've explained that to the mayor about the budget and where we're going, and I just wanted council to be aware of that too. Maybe I've said too much, but I want to say it, and thank you, Madam President, members of council.
Thank you, Mr. Barker. Appreciate your thoughts. Council, I do want to point out a couple more things to you. There is a page from one of the PowerPoint presentations that shows your ESP transfer to the general fund, and it shows a 10-year history of that for better understanding. And in 07, the rating was increased for the next year, and then we increased the transfer by $500,000. So the benefit of being able to have the infrastructure improvements and the recommendations that were put in to increase the reserves for ESP, we turned around and increased, not we, this council, but council increased the transfer, and it has been at that point ever since. And I also want to read something else into the record so you understand the ordinance, because we do have the clean copy that is being read today. But when you look at the changes, to understand the changes in customer charges and distribution charges, for residential within the city, it's going from $7 to $8.95. That's a 28% increase. For residential outside the city, it's going from $8 to $10. That's a 25% increase. Commercial within the city is going from $12 to $15.85. That's a 32% increase. Commercial outside the city is going from $14 to $18, which is a 29% increase, and that's customer charges. On the distribution charge side for city residents, residential is $6.27. It's going to $7.52. That's a 20% increase. Residential outside the city is $7.97. It's going to $9.29, which is a 17% increase. Commercial within the city for distribution charges is the same as mentioned above, the $6.27 to $7.52, which is a 20% increase. And then commercial outside the city for the distribution charge is the $7.97 and going to $9.29. The charges are going up more in the city than in the county. That's a concern as well. But I just wanted you to fully understand all of the strike-throughs that were originally presented to you and how those changes affect city residents and county residents as well. And then I do want to point out a couple things, because my biggest concern here, as I pointed out before, is that this is too important to have it be part of the budget conversation. When the last rate increase of any substantial amount was done, it was done well in advance. That was not done in this case, and I can only guess as to why. I don't know what the answer would be to that, but I also want to point out something else that is of great concern. I understand Mr. Barker talked about knowing in that quarter that there would be an issue and possibly we should have addressed it at that time, but we wanted to wait and see what would happen for the rest of the year. But I want to point you to the paperwork from September 6th. In the summary section, it's the third paragraph that ESP has an agreement with the Florida Public Service Commission, PSC, to accelerate repair and replacement of obsolete distribution system infrastructure. And then it talks about, without the identified funding mechanism to move forward, ESP will be in violation of that agreement. I had a quick conversation with Mr. Suarez and did a little more research on that. I looked at the Public Service Commission website and was very kindly supplied with a document today that is that agreement, the infrastructure replacement agreement. And this is not something that's done every year. It's not something that should be shuttled right into the budget process. It's a very important document and a rather lengthy agreement. It took a couple years to develop, but this was completed in March of this year. And this is a big issue for us that sits as the board of directors of ESP in the decisions that we make. Not only did we have the deficit that Mr. Barker was talking about, but we had this new agreement that we would have to comply with. And I do want to read the letter into the record that's March 21st, 2011. It went to C. Edward Mills, Bureau Chief Safety, Florida Public Service Commission, Division of Auditing and Safety in Tallahassee, Energy Services of Pensacola, Corrosion Control and Replacement Plan. Mr. Mills, this letter is to follow up on our meeting on Friday, March 11th, 2011, to finalize the ESP corrosion control and replacement plan. In the meeting, the following suggestions were made to be included in our plan. A, increase the frequency of main leak survey from 3 years to annually in the areas identified as a leak per mile rate, LMR, equal to or greater than 1% rather than 1.1 indicated in the original draft. Item B, include information on past main replacement progress. Item C was indicate in the plan that the plan is a one-year pilot project to gain experience predicting work pace and will be followed by a timeline to completion. The above three items were added to ESP's corrosion control and replacement plan. The final plan is attached for your records. I would like to thank you for your assistance in completing this effort. ESP ratepayers and the citizens of Pensacola will benefit from this proactive approach to manage the aging infrastructure. Also, I would like to thank you for your many years of service to the PSC and wish you good health and happiness in retirement. So I guess Mr. Mills has moved on. But it shows you that this was a final document, a final agreement back in March. And this was of great importance for council to understand that this is a new expense. This is an ongoing expense. This is going to be at least a 20-year project. So to not have this be part of consideration with the budget, that the transfer may very well be affected, and that a rate increase would certainly not just be recommended but be needed, I feel was very irresponsible. And, you know, this is a new government of transparency, and this was not a transparent action to have taken. My concern is that we now have a budget discussion with 10 days left, and we have a serious problem with an ESP. We have a transfer that we can look at as a council, whether we should be taking $8 million from a business that is being run that sorely needs replacement of its infrastructure. It's council, you have this. You can get it on off the K drive. It's actually been emailed to Ms. Major, so you can have this full report for your review. Another thing that it does talk about, though, in the commentary about the request for a variance that we're transferring some of our work, the DMP that Mr. Suarez addressed to you, but it also says that this strategy is designed to return the distribution system to integrity through managing risk of corrosion leaks with a minimal rate payer impact. And what that says to me is that we should be taking a better look at our rate transfer. Is it responsible to be transferring $8 million from a business that sorely needs its dollars to improve its infrastructure for service delivery? I do not have any amendments or suggestions. I did not develop the budget. I'm disappointed that these two issues were not discussed separate from the budget, and we're in a really bad situation at this point. Dr. Pratt.
Thank you, Madam President. I just, if I may, would like to ask Mr. Barker one clarification on what he was mentioning. You mentioned council policies on various parts of this budget, and I know we have a lot of policies. I recall that the council policy on the transfer is up to 15%. Would you clarify for me what the council policy is on rate increases for ESP?
There is no, in the financial administration policy, any policy for rate increases. Now, the rate increases have to be brought before council for approval for those increases. But a study is done, and it was submitted to council as part of this, and if approved today, you know, will be part of the ordinance, which is approved, is the rate study. So, you know, the rates have historically, since I've been with the city, went forward when there was a need for the rate increase. And as far as I know, it's been held off as long as possible until something was needed.
On some of our others, it's CPI, isn't it? Or there's a CPI rate increase
right now,
recommendation.
Right now, you know, is an ordinance policy. I look at those as two different things.
Okay.
There is an ordinance that council has adopted that said that the ESP rates will go up by the CPI, but they will be presented as part of the budget. So like when you worked on the 11 budget, it was presented as part of the workshops. It was indicated that you did not want to go up on it, so we did not increase the rates last year by CPI. So you always have the out, the way the ordinance is written, going through the budget process. And that's why the rates are discussed at budget, because the ordinance says that you will present it as part of that for the CPI, and of course council can back down on that.
So the ordinance says it'll be presented as CPI, or that it can be presented as anything?
No. The ordinance says when the rates were set that they would go up by CPI.
Uh-huh.
And but council has the right to say no.
Right.
At budget time, and that's what's happened. If there's a furtherance of a need in operations other than CPI, a rate study is done, and then that's presented to council.
Okay. Was there consideration of just raising it by CPI in your deliberations with the mayor?
The consideration of CPI is not enough. I mean, it's as simple as that. What you're looking at, you should have had the 5% that Mr. Hall had, and you're looking at a 1.9. But, you know, at the time also, we did not know that we were going to be $2.8 million short this year, or $3 million, whatever it's going to be. We haven't closed the books, but somewhere around there. So, you know, you would have had something before you, probably around a 1.9, not knowing, you know now what the numbers were, but not knowing at the time, it had probably been about a 1.9% increase, as Mr. Hall had mentioned.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Excuse me. Mm-hmm. Councilman Johnson.
Yeah, thank you very much, Madam President. You know, I'm sitting here listening to this discussion, and I've heard one council person talk about if we don't approve this rate increase that we're going to have to go back to staff and find ways to find the money. We've heard staff today talk about to keep this city physically operating and in the black, that we need this increase. So I've heard from staff, and I want to say today I'm going to make a business decision, not a political decision. And that decision is to vote and approve the rate increase that has been proposed by the mayor. So with that said, I'm ready to call the vote. Thank you.
And that is noted. That just means that you
call,
don't
call the question. Excuse me.
No, call the question would just mean that
second.
You don't wish to speak anymore. Excuse me.
He called the question. And I seconded.
Councilman Hall, excuse me, I am speaking. You do not have the floor. He may call the question. It just means that he does not want to speak anymore. You may get Robert's rules out to find that out. Excuse
okay.
me.
All right.
Could I get a clarification from that from the city attorney, please? That if I can call the question or not.
You can call the question. It simply is that you state you do not wish to speak to the question anymore.
Well, if a question is called, then the discussion's ended and we take a vote, correct?
Well, it's the previous question. Call the previous question.
Councilman Hall, please. I will recognize you when I recognize you. That's incredibly rude, and you do it all the time. Please stop. Madam Clerk, could I have clarification?
Defer to the city attorney.
Mr. Attorney.
Council President, if you just give me a second.
While you're looking that up, there are members of the audience that would like to speak, and they deserve that right. First speaker is Mr. Stephen Embry.
Thank you very much.
Welcome.
I would like to say first that I was at the Gulf Power meeting last night. Well, yesterday morning, excuse me.
Are you exhausted?
A little bit. And first thing I asked when I was there was, where's the mayor, where's the city council, where's our county commissioners, and where's the state representatives and senators for Escambia County? I did notice on my way out that Ms. Myers was standing in the back, and so you're excused.
Thank you.
But it is a good question. And why we were there at the meeting, you know, there's a, when you talk about the increase in the cost of gas for people to heat their homes, cook their food, heat their water, whatever they use it for, wash their clothes. Then you look at the increase, which is probably going to happen with Gulf Power, which is also not just a rate increase, it's a tax increase. And I'm trying to figure out how this council is coming up with some of its decisions, because I understand we're going to get a property tax cut. Well, I figured that out. That's about $12 for me. But all the fee increases are going to be hundreds of dollars. So I guess if you have $1 million home in the city of Pensacola, you're jumping up and down. But if you're just a regular working person, or in my case, a retired officer, so I'm
excuse
a
me just
off.
A minute. We heard on the microphones down at the end. If you could take your discussion away from the microphones, please.
Well, then, as a parliamentary order, then I've got a point of information. Then I would like to ask the parliamentarian, which I believe is our city attorney, on what the opinion is on the calling of the previous question.
I'll allow this citizen to finish speaking. Thank you.
All right. So what I wanted you to try to understand is, from the discussions yesterday, as you know, for the last 20 years, working people's wages have been stagnant. The last couple years, they've actually declined. When 20% of the population, this doesn't only figure in locally, it's also nationally, controls more of the wealth than the bottom 80% combined, this disparity is becoming extremely dangerous. And so now the city has decided to balance its budget on those who can afford it least. And what I would remind you is the last time in Western history this kind of separation occurred, Louis XVI and Marie Antoinette sat on the throne of France. And let's say this, things didn't turn out too good. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Messer, have you made a determination? Okay, we'll allow the next member to speak. Mr. Ellis Bullock. Welcome. Thank you for coming.
Thank you. Madam President, honorable council members, it's good to see you. Thank you for your good work and service to our city and for the opportunity to speak today. As a citizen and business owner who has had the privilege of working with ESP and also has over two decades of experience in the natural gas industry, I want to offer a few observations regarding ESP's rate and fee increase and request. In reviewing this matter, I recently thoroughly read the cost of service and rate design study, something that caught my attention that I believe should be pointed out. On page 9 of the study is a table titled Comparison of Residential Bills with the ESP Recommended Rates and Gulf Power Rates. The table clearly illustrates with the proposed rates, ESP's residential energy cost will be considerably lower than Gulf Power's for a comparable unit of energy. This is important in an enterprise environment. It is also important to note natural gas costs used in the table were based on a gas cost factor of $8. Today, gas costs $3.88, and it is highly unlikely costs will exceed $5 anytime in the years ahead, barring a confluence of multiple natural disasters. With the proposed ESP rates, energy costs to citizens will be significantly lower than the rates illustrated in the table, and ESP will be in a strong competitive positioning considering Gulf Power's pending rate increases. ESP has been operating in a lean manner for a long time. In my world of marketing, ESP is outspent in excess of 10 to 1. It is amazing to me that ESP has performed as well as it has, but I feel this is not a sustainable business or enterprise model. It has been very frustrating to me over the past that council after council have failed to adequately invest in the future of ESP, as Councilman Hall has recently pointed out in a previous meeting. Had your predecessors done so, there is no doubt that ESP today would be contributing significantly more to the city's bottom line than it currently does. ESP needs the appropriate rate structure to remain a viable enterprise. It needs resources to effectively market, to compete with a major competitor, to upgrade an aging infrastructure, resources to introduce new services such as natural gas vehicle support, resources to generate growth and more revenue. I know these are hard economic times. Councilwoman Myers and particularly Councilman Geralds speak loudly and rightfully for the fabric of our community who can least bear cost increases. I ask you to consider this. Appropriate funding could give ESP the ability to implement programs to assist families in acquiring energy-efficient appliances, resources to educate consumers on energy efficiency, resources to be more flexible with those who are struggling. It will take a few years of sacrifice and a couple of rather painless rate increases relative to the energy marketplace. But if we can give ESP the resources to truly be competitive and grow, the future benefit to the city's bottom line and thus the citizens of Pensacola will be significant. If not, future councils may face budget challenges with ESP alone and ESP's ability to maintain its current level of contribution to the city budget would greatly diminish. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Bullock. Mr. Master, did you have comment on the issue that Mr. Johnson has raised?
Yes, Madam President, Councilmember Johnson. Robert's Rules of Order instructs us that at this point there's been a proper motion, and as I understand it, second to call the question, which results in a cessation of debate among council members and a vote. Although in the interim it is appropriate to allow the public to speak, debate among council members ceases and you all vote on that. That vote being whether or not to call the question.
Thank you.
And just to make sure that everyone is on the same playing field, that vote needs a two-thirds majority.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Mr. Blaze Adams.
Good afternoon, Madam President, members of Council, staff, and Mayor's staff. Thank you for your service to our community and the extensive work you have performed in recent weeks on the deliberation of this budget. I appreciate the difficult decisions that Council must make from time to time. The proposed increase in the ESP gas rate is certainly one of those difficult decisions. This increase is necessitated by the increased costs currently experienced by every household in every business in this country. It is imperative that the infrastructure of our gas system be maintained properly. To cut expenses by reducing maintenance expenses would be unsafe and unsound. But to reduce general fund expenses would have a negative impact on numerous city departments and their ability to deliver basic services. Lastly, further depleting ESP reserves, which currently stand at 8.5% or 6.5% below the level of council policy, is nothing short of reckless. I would encourage you to consider the significant consequences of failing to approve the increase presented in the proposed 2012 budget. I know it is a difficult and unpopular decision, but the alternatives carry significant downside for the users of the system and the citizens of Pensacola. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Ms. Barbara Mayall.
Thank you, Madam President, Council, Mayor, staff. I'm not up here to badger anybody or anything. I am not an ESP user. I have chosen to have an all-electric house. In saying that, I just got back, I'd say about a month ago, from Success School in Fort Worth, and one of our guests was Bob McEwen. He's a six-time congressman and a historical commentator, and he stressed that we make a difference in our government, anyone that can. I've gone out and talked to people on a fixed income. You know, the old saying is you can't get blood from a turnip. If you've got $1,000 and your bills are $1,000 and there's an increase, then you're going to have to give up something. You're going to have to give up medical. You're going to have to give up the staples. And there are people in our community that are going to have to do that. And I heard our finance director talk about no increases for pay. Well, we haven't got an increase in over 2 years, even on people with Social Security. So, you know, I'm sorry, but, you know, I'm right along with them. So I'm going to go back to those four questions, and this is up to the council to answer those questions. And number one, is it the truth? What you've got, the data you got, is it all the truth? Number two, and is it fair to all concerned? And number three, will it build good will and better relationships? And number four, will it be beneficial to all concerned? I understand the need of safety. So in essence, that's why we have who we have on board here. I just want to end with a comment that Congressman McEwen had said. A mule entered into a horse race at the Kentucky Derby and was told, well, you know mules can't win in this race. And the man who entered the mule said, I know, but they'll be in mighty fine company.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Mayo. We have a motion and a second to call the question. Please vote. Councilman Spencer needed to... didn't realize he had stepped out.
Sorry.
We're voting on calling the question.
What do we...
Can we re-vote? Yeah, let's... Do you want to be a part of that vote?
He just pressed his button and got on there.
I'm sorry.
Okay. Mm-hmm. 6-2.
So then the question has been called, so then we take mm-hmm. a vote now then, correct?
Absolutely.
Okay.
So we have a motion and a second, and this is on the schedule of gas rates and charges. Please vote. And that is a 5-4 vote. Council. There is no further business to come before this council. That was the only agenda item. We are adjourned.